Hello, welcome back to SSL TLS lecture series. This is episode 7 and I am Saravanan learning along with you. Today we have a very packed session. The agenda is we will first go through the DES in ECB mode. That is the very basic, right? First we need to understand the basic clearly, even though we don't use DES nowadays, but I am just using it for demo purpose to understand the concept, not for the DES purpose, okay? So let's first start with the DES-ECB demo using OpenSSL. Then we will understand the concept of parity bit in DES key, okay? Then we will later, I will show you an explanation of what is a deterministic encryption. I think in the past episode, we saw the theory, right? We will see a demo of a deterministic encryption. Then we will use again OpenSSL to see a demo of DES in cipher block chaining mode. And then you will see what is the meaning of probabilistic encryption. All this theory we already covered, right? Today is just the demo part. Later we will see how block cipher actually handles the padding. Like if you give the data less than the block size, how it is adding the padding. So that concept we will see, and we will also see a demo of it. Followed by, we will also see what is a counter mode of operation and where it is used. Then we will quickly go through some of the popular websites to understand what block cipher they are using, what key size they are using, what mode of operation they are using. So that's the agenda for today. So let's get started. In the past episode, we learned about the block cipher, right? Basically, we learned about the DES algorithm, triple DES algorithm. We also learned about the AES algorithm and a lot of other things. Then we also learned about what is called a mode of operation. That is, if you want to basically use a block cipher in practice, you cannot just use a standalone block cipher. You also need what is called a mode of operation. All the theory we already learned, right? In the mode of operation, we learned about the electronic code book mode. Then we also learned about the cipher block chaining mode. So today we are going to see a demo of it. So let's see the demo. So first let us see the OpenSSL version. So whenever you use OpenSSL or any command for that matter, you should always check the right what version you are using, because depending on different version, the features might be different. So here I am using OpenSSL 1.0.2m. OpenSSL has a module called ENC, which is used for all the encryption, decryption related cipher. So you can actually check the help for this. Unfortunately, like I mentioned in past episode, OpenSSL doesn't have a help command. So whenever you give a wrong parameter, it will complain that this is wrong, and then it will provide the corresponding help. So let's use the technique. So I just type some junk minus H. It will actually produce the thing. If you look at the beginning, right, it will say this is an illegal command, unknown option minus H, right? Then it will print what is the help. So here, what we are going to focus today is only two things. We will go through DES. DES is nothing but DES-CBC, both are alias to each other. Then we will also go through the ECB mode, dash DES-ECB, okay? We are only going to use these two things today. So if you want to learn more about this command, you can actually go through the OpenSSL ENC man page. So let's quickly look at the man page. So if you look at this, right, look at this. So DES is nothing but, it is an alias for DES-CBC mode of operation. So whether you use dash DES or whether you use dash DES-CBC, both are same. We are going to use this as well as the DES-ECB mode of operation today, okay? Here I am using the jet shell. So if you use bash shell, you can also use bash shell. So jet shell, sometime what will happen is if you type anything, like for example, when I say echo minus n high, it will always produce this percentage if there is a no line ending. Whereas if you use bash shell, you don't have this, straight away the prompt will follow your output, okay? So don't worry about the percentage. You can just ignore the percentage symbol in my console output. So first what we are going to do is we will call the OpenSSL, the so-called encrypt module. And then we will invoke the DES-ECB. Then I am going to say encrypt, right? So for encryption, the command is minus E. To pass the key, the command is uppercase K. Then I want to pass a key. So what I will do is I will just use a hexadecimal character. Since the key is 56 bit, right? For 56 bit, it is 7 byte of character you have to provide. But in practice, what will happen is, even though the key size in DES is 56 bit, you have to provide 64 bit as the key. Automatically, the algorithm will throw away 8 bits from the key. Later, we will discuss which bit it will throw away. 8 bits from the key, and it will only use 56 bit internally to perform the encryption or decryption. However, you have to still provide 64 bit, okay? The additional 8 bit is called parity bit, okay? Okay, first, before we move on, let's really give you a 64 bit and then do a simple encryption and see how it goes. So what I'm going to do is, I just give you a hexadecimal character as a key. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Then I will use A, B, C, D, E, F. So I got a 16 hexadecimal digit, which is equivalent to 8 byte, which is 8 times 8, 64 bit. Okay. So let's encrypt something. So what I'm going to do is, I will just say echo. I'm going to encrypt only one letter. Okay. I'm just using the English lowercase letter A. So let's encrypt and see what it produces, the encrypted output. So it produces a binary output. Since we cannot read the binary output, what I am going to do is, I am going to octal dump minus type hexadecimal, show me in hexadecimal one byte at a time. That is the meaning of this command. Of course, if you are from Unix or Linux background, all of you might have used the OD command, right? So the output, it is producing 8 byte. You might be wondering, right? I only gave one letter, why it's producing 8 byte? Because DES is a block cipher, input is going to be 64 bit, output is also going to be 64 bit. So if you just give one letter, automatically it will add padding bytes, and then the output is also going to be 64 bit. That's why we got 64 bit here, okay? Okay, for the time being, don't worry about the output. What I want to discuss here is, let's say instead of the 64 bit, right, I will only provide 56 bit key. See what happened. Does it complain? It should complain, right? Because I told, even though key size is 56, the algorithm will still need a 64 bit, right? So I purposely give one less byte, that is 56 bit. Let's see what it does. It is still going ahead and encrypting, right? But if you look at the output is different. That means OpenSSL internally is doing something, right? So let's see what OpenSSL internally it is doing. So what I will do is, I will tell OpenSSL, hey OpenSSL, please don't encrypt. Just tell me what is the key that you are using. Okay. So I am going to say minus uppercase P means don't encrypt. Just show me what key you took. So let's see what it produced. So here it says the key it took is this. So when we give 56 bit key, automatically OpenSSL is appending a 00, right? So because of that, internally your key got changed. That's why you got a totally different output. Okay. So don't do this mistake, don't use 56 bit. If you have to use DES, you have to provide 64. The algorithm automatically, internally, it will throw away 8 parity bit. Let's see what is those parity bits are. So in DES, I told you that the key size is going to be 56 bit. So you can write 56 as 87 bit, right? 87 bit. So you can write like this. So first one, second one, third one, fourth one, fifth one, sixth one, seventh one, eighth one. Okay, this is 1, 2, up to 8 I have. So they are all 7 bit, right? But the DES standard says, even though you only need 7 bit, you have to add a 8th bit here, okay? So this is going to be your 8th bit. This 8th bit is called parity bit. So I am counting from left to right, my one start on the left. So every 8th bit is a parity bit. So 16th bit, 24th bit. So now you are converting your 8 times 7 into 8 times 8. That is, your key size will become now 64 bit. Okay. Because you are adding a parity bit at every 8th position. So 8th bit, 16th bit, 24th bit, 32nd bit, something like that. Right. Then you will add the last one. So last one is 64th bit. They are all parity bit. As soon as you submit 64 bit key, internally it will first throw away the so-called 8th bit. It will throw away 8th bit, 16th bit, 24th bit, 32nd bit, etc. It will only take the remaining bit. This is what we mean by parity bit. Parity bit is a concept came from the communication theory. In communication, electronic communication, if you want to do a data error detection, right? Just a 1 bit kind of error detection. you can use the parity bit. Because DES came in the very olden days, what the standard says is, whenever you generate the key or transmit the key or store the key for data error detection purpose, you should also include this so-called parity bit, and you must keep the parity in odd parity. What that means is, let's say I have a value something like this, my 7 bit value of the key is something like this, 1111111, this is my 7 bit, okay? So if you count the number of 1, there are total 7 ones are there, so 7 is a odd number. So what the standard says is, after adding the so-called parity bit, the resulting byte should become a odd parity. Since our 7 bit is already odd parity, I don't have to add anything. So what I will do is, I will just add a 0 here, so that the resulting 8 bit will become odd, okay? Let's take another example, 1111110. So in this case, there are only 6 ones are there, that means it's an even number, right? So what the standard says is, you should add a parity bit as 1. So I will add a 1 here. So the resulting, if you now count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 ones are there, so my resulting byte will maintain the odd parity. So this is the concept typically used in the communication theory for the error detection and error detection purpose. But nowadays, what almost all the implementation, it doesn't care about the parity bit. As soon as you provide the bit, it will throw away the 8th bit, 16th bit, 24th bit, 32nd bit. That is basically every 8th bit it will throw away, okay? So let's see a demo of this, how it is throwing away the 8th bit, okay? This is my key, right? I use a very easy key, FE, 4 byte, 5, 6, 7, 8. I have 8 bytes, right? Now I am going to encrypt, and I will see the output using octal dump. So this is my encrypted output, right? What I am going to do is, I will change the key itself. I will change the key to FF, okay? If you change the key, the output should change, right? So let's see what happened. See, even though I change the key, the output is not changing, right? So what happened here? If you carefully look, I didn't change the key. I only changed the parity bit, right? So let me draw this again. So if you look at FE, right? FE is nothing but 1111. E is nothing but 1110, right? So I only touch the parity bit, I convert the parity bit as 1, that will result in FF, right? So for outsider, it looked like you have changed the key, but I didn't change the key, I only changed the parity bit from FE to FF. So that's why the output is still the same, because internally it will throw away the parity bit. You should always keep this in mind, okay? Otherwise, you will feel like, hey, how come I changed the key, the output is still not changing, right? Because here I have touched the parity bit, okay? Parity bit. First thing the algorithm will do is throw away all the parity bits. We will see one more example. Now I am going to change 2 bytes, right? So every byte I am only touching the parity bit. Again, I made it FF. That means I am only touching the parity bit. So output should be the same now. See, the output is still same, right? Okay. So we learned about how parity bit is working in DES. Now that we learned about the encryption, let's also do the decryption, okay? So this is the encrypted output. So let's try to decrypt this guy, okay? Open SSL, you call the encrypt module, same DES-ECB. For decryption, I have to use minus D, lowercase d. The key is still same. So I will just copy paste my key. So you will see the decrypted output. So you can see the A here, right? You ignore the percentage. I already told why you see the percentage there, okay? So we learn how to encrypt and decrypt using OpenSSL. If you have noticed this, let's say I will do the encryption again, okay? This is the encryption. If I try to, I have not changed my key, I have not changed my plain text, I am just redoing my encryption. So what is the output here? It's still the same, right? So every time, if you don't change the key, if you don't change the plain text, you will always get the same output. This is what we mean by deterministic encryption. Remember the theory we saw, whenever you give x1 without changing the key, you always get y1 right. In the past episode I discussed. So this is what we mean by deterministic encryption. The output will never change if you don't change the key and the input. But we learned in the theory that this is not a good thing because the cryptanalyst can attack it. So you should never ever use the ECB mode of operation, right? Okay. So you learn what is a deterministic encryption. Next, we see a demo of how the padding is working in block cipher. For that, again, I'm going to use the DES. You can also use AES if you want, just for simplicity, because I don't want to type a very long key with AES. So for simplicity, I will just use DES, okay? So if you look at the previous command, right, I only provided a single letter. So my input is only 8-bit, right? Yet my output is 64-bit because DES has automatically added 7 bytes of padding, okay? 7 bytes of padding to the input. So what logic it is using to add the padding byte? So this has been actually described in the standard. So let's quickly see what logic it is using. The most commonly used padding, right? It's actually, you can find them in the public key cryptography standard. So this standard was itself is created by a company called RSA Security. This company was formed by the people who invented the RSA algorithm. So they are the one who formed this company. So when they formed this company, they created a lot of standard and they called them public key cryptography standard. And they have lot of standard 1, standard 2, lot of numbers are there. Among them, there is also a standard called standard 7. So if you look at the standard 7, inside you can find what kind of padding you should use. Okay. When they created this, it is their company property. Later, some of the standard they released to Internet Engineering Task Force so that it can be used freely by the public, and it came in the form of RFC as well. So if you want to see how the padding and other thing is being done, you can actually refer the RFC. The RFC is RFC 5652. Okay. It basically defines the cryptographic message standard. So let's quickly see this RFC, how it is doing the padding. So this is the RFC 5652. It's called cryptographic message syntax. So if you look for padding, right, you will find the padding has been described somewhere here. So I will quickly summarize what this paragraph is saying. Okay. So this padding rule says, let's say you have only 1 byte, right? In our case, I have only 1 byte. That means I need to add 7 bytes of padding character, right? So what the standard says is, so let's say instead of 1 byte, you have 7 bytes. That means you have to 1 byte of padding, right? So the standard says you just add a hexadecimal number 01. Okay, just add a 01 to mean you to represent you need 1 byte of padding. So the character 01 will act as a padding byte. Let's say your input is 6 bytes. That means you need to add 2 bytes of padding, right? So what you should do is you add hexadecimal 0202. Two times you have to add. If you have 5 bytes of plain text, you need to add 3 bytes of padding. So what you will do is hexadecimal 030303. Three times you have to add. So you continue this logic. So for 7, if your input is just only 1 byte, right? In our case, we just use a lowercase a, right? So that means you need to add 7 bytes of padding, right? So what the standard says is just add the character 07070707. 7 times 070707. So I added 7 times, right? 1 2 3 4 5 6 7. Okay, 7 times. So what if my input is exactly block size, right? Exactly block size. Let's say I give 8 bytes. My input is exactly block size. Theoretically, we should not add any padding, right? Because my input is already exactly 8 bytes. But if I don't add padding, there is a difficulty. I don't know which byte is my plain text. I don't know which byte is my padding test. So to differentiate between plain text and the padding byte, what the standard says is, if your input is perfectly 8 bytes, that is if your input perfectly follow the block size, you have to still add the padding. In this case, you have to add block size number of padding byte. In DES, our block size is 8 bytes, right? So basically what you have to do is, you have to add the character 08 up to 8 times. 8 times you have to add this character, okay? So that's how the padding is working. It has been documented both in RFC as well as in the PKCS standard. You can refer them. So let's see a quick demo of this padding again. So initially I gave only 1 byte, right? Here I gave 1 byte, I got additional 7 bytes because of padding. Now what I will do is, instead of 1 byte, I give 7 bytes, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That means it will add 1 byte of padding. See, it has added 1 byte, so my output is still 8 bytes. Now I will give perfect block size. Perfect block size is 8 byte, 8 times 8, 64, right? 64 bit I will give. See, instead of 64 bit, now I get 128 bit. I am getting 16 bytes of output. Because, like I explained, even though you pass a block size, perfect block size as a 8 byte, we need to differentiate where the padding starts, right? So, it will automatically add another block of padding byte. That is, extra 8 bytes it will add as a padding byte. So, that's how the padding works, okay? Okay, next we are going to see the demo of the CBC mode. If you remember from my past episode, in CBC mode, how does it work? You typically pass the plain text value, then you pass the initialization vector, both will get XORed, right? It will become XOR. So then whatever output it comes, you will encrypt the output, right? This is the encryption you are doing using the key K, right? Then the resulting is called cipher. So you will usually take this and you will pass it as a IV for the next block, right? So this is how the CBC was working. We have already gone through all these things in the past episode, so I won't go here. So basically for CBC mode to encrypt along with the key K, you also need the initialization vector, right? So the key is, even though it is 56 bit, on command line you should always pass 64 bit, which we already saw. For IV, it has to be same as your block size. In DES, your block size is 64 bit, so your IV should be also be 64 bit. Okay, let's see a demo. Okay, here what I am going to do is, I have a word called secret. I want to encrypt that word. So as usual, I am using the OpenSSL ENC module. I am going to invoke the DES-CBC cipher minus lowercase e mean do the encryption. IV, if you notice, I use 64 bit IV, right? I have written in hexadecimal. Key also I use 64 bit key, okay? If you are not confident, you can always ask OpenSSL before encrypting, show me what is the key and IV that you are using, okay? You can use uppercase P, it will show what is the key that you have taken, what is the IV it has taken. Then you can perform the encryption, okay? As usual, I am going to use the octal dump because the output is going to be binary. So this is my encrypted output in CBC mode, DES-CBC mode. So let's also do the decryption. For decryption, all you have to do is just repeat the same command. OpenSSL ENC DES-CBC minus D for decryption. This IV, all this thing is exactly same, okay? So I will just do a cut and paste here. So now I will get back my original plain text. See, I got my original plain text. So what we learned is how to do encryption and decryption using DES-CBC mode. Then we will see the effect of the IV, right? Remember in the past theory class, we saw what is called a probabilistic encryption. Probabilistic encryption means every time you should keep changing the IV. You should never reuse the IV more than once, okay? So every time we should keep changing the IV. So what I will do here is, so this is the first time I am encrypting. Let us look at the output. This is the output, right? Next time, I should never ever reuse the same IV. That is the theory, right? So I will change the IV. I will just use 00 here. So let's see what happened. My key is not changed. My input is not changed. Only the IV, the so-called IV nonce value has changed, okay? Look at the output. Output is different, right? Again, you come here. You change only the IV. I will just use the letter 1. See, again the output is different. That means even though the plain text is same, key is also same, every single time you do the encryption, the output will be continuously different even though the input is still same. Okay, this is what we mean by probabilistic encryption. That is, the output is going to be a random number even if your input is same, key is same, because of the effect of the initialization vector. Next, what we are going to see is the one more mode of operation called counter mode of operation. So in counter mode of operation, what we will do is, for our initialization value, initialization vector, we divide them into two parts. The first part we call it n, is actually the n is also a nonce. Then you concatenate the n with a counter value. For example, let's take the AES cipher, right? In AES cipher, what is the block size? Block size is nothing but 128 bit, right? I told you when we use IV, the IV size should be same as the block size. That means I have to use a 128 bit IV. We can divide them into 96 bit nonce and then a 32 bit counter, right? So 96 plus 32, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So we get 122, right? So you can basically divide your IV into two parts. The first part, we will again call it nonce. Nonce means number used only one. The second part, we will use a simple counter. Our counter always start with a zero. In this example, our counter will start with zero. For every block, you basically increment the counter. That means no two block will have the same value of IV because the counter we will continuously increment. It's a 32 bit counter. Every block we will increment, okay? Let's see how the encryption happens in the counter mode of operation. Initially I will have my n concatenate with your counter, which is nothing but zero, right? In the beginning you will have zero. Then you provide this value to the encryption block. This is your AES cipher or whatever. The block cipher can be anything, okay? So let's assume for simple example AES here. So if this is your encryption block, then the output is nothing but whatever output it gets, you basically XOR this output along with your plain text. This is your plain text P1, okay? Then you will get the corresponding output. If you carefully notice this, your encryption is happening using what is the called a XOR operation, right? Your encryption is not happening using AES. This is the AES. Your AES is sitting here. That means when you use counter mode, the counter mode automatically turns your AES cipher into a stream cipher, right? XOR operation means we learned XOR operation is nothing but a stream cipher, right? Remember RC4? In RC4, we learned it. That's how it works, right? Stream cipher means you basically use the XOR for both encryption and decryption. Here, the actual plain text is getting encrypted using XOR. That is a stream cipher. So you are using a block cipher basically to generate your key stream, right? Your block cipher output is always random, right? Because of that, because you are using IV, so your output will be random. So here you are converting a block cipher into your stream cipher. You have to remember this. This is an important concept. Whenever you use counter mode, even though it say AES, internally you are converting AES into your stream cipher. Okay, block cipher into your stream cipher. So effective encryption is happening actually using a stream cipher. Okay. So the next block, so how does the next block work? So my next block is nothing but I will take the counter, I will increment by 1, okay? I will just increment the counter by 1. By nonce is still same, but effective IV is not n, right? This is the effective IV, this is the effective initialization vector. So I am not reusing my IV because my counter is getting incremented. So then as usual, you encrypt using your block cipher. Then the output will come, you XOR the output, your plain text is nothing but P2, then you will get your ciphertext C2. So if you carefully look at this, the only difference between one block and other block is you are just incrementing the counter. That is a formula everyone knows, right? That means each block is totally independent of each other. There is no feedback going from one block to another block. They are completely independent. That means you can parallelly perform encryption and decryption both in hardware as well as in software. Because of that, the counter mode of operation will be very very fast both in software as well as in hardware. Not only that, when you use the counter mode, right, your encryption decryption, you don't need a separate engine for encryption and decryption because you are essentially doing the XOR, right? When you use XOR, encryption and decryption are both same, right? So you don't need a separate engine to perform your encryption and decryption. The important concept to remember when we use the initialization vector, right? For example, in the counter mode, what we saw is your IV is nothing but n concatenate with the counter value, right? You should never ever reuse this IV. The moment you reuse the IV, automatically remember from the IV only you are encrypting and then you are generating the keystream, right? So if you reuse the IV, automatically your keystream will be the same. Your keystream will get reused. And then the underlying the block cipher will become vulnerable, right? It provides a way to decrypt the plain text. Let's see a very quick example of what I am talking about, okay? Let's see a very quick example. Let's take RC4. Let's take RC4. In RC4, what we learned is you basically provide a key. In practice, people will always provide a key concatenate with a nonce value. So this will act as your seed value. Then it will go inside what is called a key stream generator. Then it will produce what is called a key stream, right? You will usually use this key stream. You will have your plain text here. Then you will produce your ciphertext C1. So essentially your ciphertext C1 is nothing but plain text performing a XOR with key stream, right? If you reuse the N value for the same key K, you will end up with the exact same K and N for the, you will end up with the exact same value, right? If you reuse the nonce for the same key K, you will end up with the same value of this. That means it is still going to produce the same KS, right? So what will happen is your C2 is P2 XR, you will end up with the same KS, right? Because you are reusing this fellow for the key K. So now the attacker, what he will do is he will take both the ciphertext which he can see. He will perform a XR on your ciphertext. What it will happen is P1 XR KS XR P2 XR KS. So in XR logic, if you have the same variable, it will get cancelled, right? So effectively what you will get is P1 XR P2. This is what we mean by XR of plain text. If you provide this to a crypt analyst, he can easily break this, right? So you should never ever allow to provide the XR of plain text. This is the weakest point. If you can provide this to a crypt analyst, they can break this, okay? So because of this weakness, when we handle block cipher with the nonces, we have to be extremely careful. We should never ever reuse the nonce for the same key K. In this case, when we say nonce, we are talking about the so-called initialization vector, okay? If you remember the recent Wi-Fi crack attack, right? This crack attack is nothing but it will force the so-called Wi-Fi device to reuse the nonce value. That's how the whole crack attack is working, right? So that's why I'm saying you should never ever reuse the nonce value. In this case, when we say nonce, we are actually talking about the entire initialization vector, okay? So when we talk about counter mode, quite often what will happen is you don't see the counter mode used separately with your AES, for example, AES cipher. It usually comes inside some other mode of operation. For example, if you take the Galois counter mode, right? So it's called Galois counter mode. The C here actually represents the counter mode, Galois counter mode, okay? So the most common example is people use AES DCM, right? AES with the Galois counter mode of operation. So essentially, internally, it is still using a counter mode. There is another example. For example, if you use Wi-Fi, right? In Wi-Fi, what will happen? Let's say you are using a Wi-Fi client, right? You have your access point here. So this is your Wi-Fi communication. In order to protect your Wi-Fi communication, all the Wi-Fi standards are usually inside the IEEE 802.11. When they invented the 802.11, they initially came up with a protocol called web protocol, the so-called wired equivalent privacy protocol, which basically uses RC4. Later they found that it is totally weak, not secure, and then they created a updated standard called 802.11 I amendment, in which they created a new protocol called counter mode CBC MAC protocol. Counter mode is usually called counter mode CBC MAC protocol, okay? CBC MAC protocol. This fellow is actually nothing but AES. It uses a mode called counter mode CBC MAC, CCM. It's called CCM mode of operation, okay? CCM mode of operation. So this mode of operation is also using counter mode. The first letter C represents counter mode. Counter mode CBC MAC. So this counter usually comes in different mode of operation. Internally, you can find this counter mode, okay? Next, we are going to see a quick demo of, in the most popular website, how to find the what block cipher it is using, what is the key size it is using, what is the mode of operation it is using. Of course, there are a lot of other things to related to this so-called cipher speed. But in this episode, we will only focus on three things: what block cipher it is using, what key size it is using, what mode of operation it is using. Okay, let's see the demo. Now I have gone inside https://www.google.com.sg. So if you click the lock button here and then you go inside, I am using Firefox browser, go into the more information. Look at this. Here this fellow is using AES, right? AES for block cipher. The key size it is using is 128-bit. The mode of operation it is using is GCM mode, right? Galois counter mode. So don't worry about all other things. We will deal with them later. We are only focusing on three things. For block cipher, that is for your application data, it is using AES cipher. It is using the key size of 128-bit, okay? Then it is for mode of operation, it is using GCM mode of operation. Okay, next we will look at the second website. Here I am going to go into the www.citibank.com.sg. So I am inside the website. I am going to click the lock icon, arrow, more information. For block cipher, it is using AES block cipher. For key, because it's a bank website, it has to use top secret, like highest possible encryption. So it is using 256-bit for the key. Then it is also using Galois counter mode of operation, right? So we are focusing only on three things. What block cipher it is using to encrypt your application data. What is the key size it is using? What is the mode of operation it is using? Other thing, you don't worry. The third example we are going to look at is a website called Indian Institute of Technology Madras. So here I am again using HTTPS protocol. I have gone inside www.iitm.ac.in. So let's again click the lock icon. Go inside. More information. So again, if you look at it, it is using AES to encrypt your application data. Because this is not a banking website or any finance website, it's just an educational institution. So they are using a slightly lower key, 128-bit key. And if you notice, they are using a different mode of operation, right? CBC, cipher block chaining mode of operation. Okay. So by this example, we learned in a real website, what kind of block cipher they are using, what is the key size they are using, what mode of operation they are using. Okay. We can stop here. So in this episode, what we learned, in the beginning, I told you how the DES-ECB mode of operation is working, right? Basically, you have to provide, instead of 56-bit key, you have to provide 64-bit key. We learned what is called a parity bit and how parity bit affect, right? So for outsider, it will look like even if you change the key, the cipher is same, right? Actually, in my demo, I didn't change the key. I only changed the parity bit. That means the algorithm will throw away all the 8th bit, 16th bit, 24th bit, basically all the 8th bit it will throw away from your 64-bit input. Internally, it will only use 56-bit key for both encryption and decryption. We also learned that in ECB mode, since we are providing only plain text and key, if you don't change the plain text and key, the output is still going to be the same. This is what we mean by deterministic encryption. That means for the same key K, if you don't change your input, you will always get the same output, okay? Then in CBC mode, we saw a demo. We learned what is the probabilistic encryption. That is, along with the K, you also provide a IV so that even for the same input, every time because the IV is changing, the output is going to be different. This is what we mean by probabilistic encryption, right? Then we also learn how the block cipher typically do the padding of your input if your input doesn't fit the block size, right? Remember the RFC, the so-called PKC standard 7, all the things we saw. Then we learned about the counter mode of operation. We also learned counter mode of operation is also used indirectly in other mode of operation such as GCM, Galois counter mode with CBC MAC protocol, etc. Right? We also saw an example of how, what kind of block cipher, key size and mode of operations are used in some of the popular websites. Okay, with this we will stop here. Thanks for joining with me in today's episode. I will see you again in the next episode. Thank you.